day, Easter service 10 a.m. and communion and egg hunt after 10 a.m. service. Events and other announcements. Friday, April the 9th, men's ministry 6:30, fellowship fun with friends, meal and message included. Sunday, April the 11th, Rafter J reunion 10 a.m., kickoff to church service in the arena. Thursday, April the 15th, kickoff to the weekly Thursday night book out starts at 7 p.m. Registration fee is $15 for a ride or $20 unlimited ride. Saturday, April the 17th, Terrell Jubilee. See Andy for more details. Sunday, April the 18th, Elder Meeting. Open meeting starts at 6 p.m. and closed meeting starts at 7 p.m. What kind of jewelry does the Easter Bunny wear? 14 karat gold.
Everything now I'm on this blessed morning. Happy Easter, everybody. Happy Resurrection morning. Amen? Well, so good to have y'all here today. And I'm going to ask a question just like I do. Just because it's a holiday, you're not getting a break. Y'all answer me with all your heart. Are y'all happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? You expected a blessing this morning. All right. Well, we're going to praise His name. And as always, that means making a joyful noise to the Lord, clapping your feet, and did it again. Clapping your hands, stomping your feet. Yep, y'all do all that kind of stuff. Anyway, y'all just help us out because we're going to celebrate Him this morning. Amen? With your beautiful, sweet, sweet song. Your beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. Your beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I'll sing again. Thank you.
they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes he causes me to tremble.
Future. Angels
First day of the week, very early in the morning, they came into the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and the third day rise again. Thank you. this temple down, he said, and in 3 days I will be there. Jesus had died before we all could be saved. That is how God did it. Those who had a peace thought they had seen his end. They did not know the cross would be his will to him. He is risen. He is risen. Yes, my Lord, he is risen today. Well, yes, we must say, but that is all that remains. There's nobody left in that grave. Sing it with us. He is risen. He is risen. Yes, my Lord. I kind of asked the guys to change the format just a little bit, so we have added an extra song, so we actually have 2 songs left now, not just one, just in case. I know people like to count. Oh, okay, that's the second song, that's the third song. Well, one more song, they're done, we get to hear some preaching, and after that we get to go home.
What you said, I've been fooling them all these years because I can't count higher than 4.
No longer. One day the stone rolls away from the
hold him. Rain could not keep him from rising again. If he loves me, dying he saves me. Carry, he carries my sin all away.
let you go for just a second, Brother Bars. We get the other microphone together. If it is your first time ever being here with us this morning, we just want to say welcome home. Amen. It's so good to have you here today. We do things a little differently. We don't pass an offering plate, but the Lord leads you to bless the ministry in that manner. There's a little wooden church house right back there at the back door. And right after service, we'll have some folks right there to meet with you, answer any questions you might have about us, and get to know a little bit more about you. Most importantly, back there by that little church house, in the seats ahead of you, some little green sheets of paper. If the Lord speaks to your heart today and you come to a decision for Him for the first time, take just a moment, please, and fill that out. It's the most important decision you're going to come to on this side of eternity. We just sure love to stand with you and stand beside you as you start on that journey. Brother Bob, are you there?
I'm ready. Prayer request, guys. Yes, ma'am. Oh. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Pat Rhodes and Shannon and Mike Malone.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I have a coworker who was supposed to work overnight, and he had a stroke on Thursday. So, keeping him in our prayers.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Anybody else? It's going once and going twice. I'll speak for the Lord. Father, we love you so, so very much. Well, we come together here today just on a very special day, Lord, because it represents the very moment that you paved the way so that we could have eternal life. But without you rising from the grave, there's nothing. But it's hopelessness. But because you have conquered death, Lord, and through you we can conquer death as well. Lord, you did that so that we could be with you for eternity in heaven. We love you and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy and your love. Father, you heard the prayer request, Lord, just from so many different things. There's cancers, and in the midst of that, there's at least two cancers. Father God, I know this is another word starts with C with you. Lord, I'm a living testimony that you heal people from cancer. You took that brain cancer from me, Father God, when it came back. Lord, I give you praise and glory, Father. In fact, everything that we do here today, may it bring glory to your name, Father God. We don't want to think about what old Bob's bringing, Lord. We want to hear from you. That's what we want to hear today. Father, I just ask you, use me as that willing vessel, Father God. I humble myself before you. Father, I pray that, that you just have your willing way. I know that there's one common thread that unites us all together, and that is your Holy Spirit dwelling in each and every one of us. Father, I just ask that you do a little networking here today and just move through your people. Father God, descend on your church here today. Father God, we thank you for the prayers that you've answered. Father, we look forward to see what else you're going to do in our lives and in our church. Father, I can't help but think about maybe there's a person here today that's coming to the church or they're watching on YouTube or Facebook Live. Father, they have an emptiness in their heart. They don't know what's missing. They just know something is missing. Father, we know what's going to fit there. It's your Son. It's your Spirit. Father, I pray that by the end of this service that they would cry out to you. They'd humble themselves before you. They would repent. And they would ask you to come into their lives and ask Christ to fill that emptiness that they have. And it's in His precious, precious name that we pray. Amen. All right, kiddos. Dismissed. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 27. We're going to be in chapter 27 and 28 here today. Not all of it. We're going to be in both of them. You know, I remember when I was a kid, we were going to go on a family trip to Six Flags for the first time. You ever done that? You ever been to Six Flags when a kid? You know what I'm talking about? It was an experience for us. Man, we were just looking forward to it. And They had Dick Ben roller coaster. Y'all talking about that Big Ben? That was something else for a youngin' like me. I was a teenager, but guys, I tell you what, when I went, got on that ride finally, I thought surely when I got off there, it was gonna have the imprints of my hands in that rail in front of me. It was that crazy. I mean, just the highs and lows that you experience going down these roller coasters. You know, one of the there's probably 65 or more roller coasters built every year. I think the world record is probably as far as speed and as far as this vertical drops is in the Six Flags in New Jersey. It's the Kinder Car roller coaster. It goes from 0 to 138 miles per hour in 4 seconds. That's hooking them. That sits you back against your seat going hooking them. You know what I'm talking about? That's fast. And then they have a vertical, 100% complete vertical drop. Woo, boy, I don't want to ride that roller coaster. I do not want to ride it. After being, in fact, I think the last one I rode was another one at Six Flags. They said, you got to ride the wooden roller coaster. That thing about killed me.
Yeah.
Jarred every bone in my body. About that time, I said, well, I'm getting a little bit too old for these things. So I haven't been back to Six Flags since. Maybe just for the grandkids or something one time, I think. Anyway, guys, you're just, you know, I can only think of one other ride like that, and that is in Matthew chapter 27 and 28. And I call it a roller coaster because it's a roller coaster of emotions on that day. There's emotional lows and there's emotional highs all on that day, like a roller coaster ride. Right? You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
Title of today's message is, Were You There? Were You There? That's the reason I wanted to do that song, because it fits the sermon just to kind of wrap itself around that song. But you know, I can understand things better if I can place myself there. You know what I'm talking about? I want to be there. If I can get there, in other words...
Behind you.
A what?
Oh, your water.
Hocky pokey. Mama got me an oath. I never would have known it, except for the wetness on the Bible. But anyway, guys, if I can put you there, you'll remember this. Amen? You'll remember it. I have three questions for you today, and they all have to start with the same three words. Were you there? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when he rose up from the grave? Let's take that first one. Were you there when he was crucified? Chapter 27, verse 35, beginning of verse 35. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed a written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. I think that's a charge. That's a mantle. Yeah, that's a crown. All right. Two robbers were crucified with him. One on the right, on his right, and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it up and build it in three days, save yourself. Come down from that cross if you are the Son of God." Jesus had the power to come down off that cross, didn't he? He had the power not to go up to the cross. He didn't have to. He did it because he loved us. There was a passion about the cross, about the Christ, about the crucifixion. Because he loved us so much that he went to the cross. Yeah, he could have, got down off that cross. But Jesus knew if he had come down off that cross, then he wouldn't have died. He wouldn't have went to the grave. And if he hadn't went to the grave, he wouldn't have risen. And without a risen Lord, God said, none of it works. None of it works. And without without him dying, it doesn't work. He has to die for our sins so that we can have a Redeemer.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? I said I wanted to put you there. I think one of the best places, and this is not going to be in your up there, words. You're going to turn in your Bibles to Psalm 22. It's the best description of what happened on the cross, I believe, that the Bible gives. Beginning in verse 7. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. We just read it, right? He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Just mocking, just insulting him. Guys, let me tell you something. Were you there? I was there. Those were my insults thrown at him. When he called me, and I wasn't ready, I wanted to live like I continue to live like I wanted to, I was insulting him. Amen? Were you there? Because I was. Because it was my insults towards my Lord. Verse 14 says, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. The Roman crosses then, guys, the Roman soldiers were, they were experts in torture. Their job was to keep someone alive as long as they could and torture them, make it as miserable of a death as they could. After Christ had been beaten with the cat of nine tails, and by the way, he was beaten on the front of his body as well, not just his back. He was just red ribbons of blood where his flesh was ripped from his bones. But it says, my bones are out of joint. What they would do, they had these crosses, and once they laid them down on that cross, the holes, they didn't drive them into the wood, God. They had holes there already. And they would pull their shoulders out of joint, completely out of joint, and then pin them to that cross. Amen? And they nailed it to his feet. When they nailed their feet, they hit a cluster of nerves there. See, because they pulled their shoulders out of joint so they couldn't raise up with their shoulders to get a breath of air. The only way they could get a breath of air is if they pushed up against those nerves that would send pain throughout their whole body just to get a breath. Guys, I was there. Were you there? That was my sin. Every ping of the hammer belongs to me. Belongs to you if you're saved. Anybody that sinned, we put Jesus on the cross. We nailed him to the tree. He goes on to say in verse 14, my heart has turned to wax. It is melted away within me. There's a comment, I don't know, it's like a scientific name for it, I don't remember what it is, but it's where you go through so much pressure, tension on the body. And keep in mind, guys, it started in the Garden of Gethsemane when Christ was praying, asking God to let this cup pass me. The Bible says that he was worried up to the point of death. He was in, you know what I'm saying? He was just depressed. But he was so intense that he was sweating blood. It was that intense. That carried over to the cross, guys. And in the whole world, the sin of the world came down on his shoulders on that cross. Guys, that was all he could bear. and his heart literally exploded inside his chest. The heart is surrounded by a pleural cavity of fluid. And when that soldier pierced his side, because he's going by to break his legs so he'd die a little quicker, didn't break his legs because he thought he was dead, so he pierced him with the spear. And he set the water, blood and water free to flow. And that's proof that our Lord and Savior died of a broken heart for us. Amen. Goes on to say in verse 16, dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men has encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count my bones. That's what I mean, guys. I think Mel Gibson, the Passion of the Cross, depicts it the best. When he was in the praetorium and he was on the cobblestones there, and he was chained to the post there in that thing, and they were beating him with a can of nine tails, ripping his flesh off his back. They turned him over and continued to do it across his chest and exposed his ribs. So when he said, I can see my bones, he literally, guys, I believe this to happen like this. After he was nailed to the cross, they raised the cross up and it dropped down in that hole. And at that point, I think Jesus probably looked down and saw his bones exposed from just the ribbons. Every slash of the cat of nine tails was mine. Every one. Were they yours? Yes. Yes, they were. Could you just imagine the grief of that day? I mean, just experience the grief. And then the cross that he carried up to Golgotha, the skull, the cross he carried up, it's not like the ours is probably more of a depiction of what the cross was. But you know, in these churches, we have the nice, pristine, sanded wood crosses. There was an old rugged cross. They split them, and they were splinterous. And the Lord, when they put him on there, could you imagine the pain of the ribbons on your flesh going against a rough, rugged cross? Amen. Can you see the crucifixion? Did I do a good enough job of putting you there? Were you there? Were you there? Not only were you there when they crucified my Lord, but were you there when they laid him in the tomb? 57 through 66. Back to it. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of a rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. The next day, the one after the preparation day, the chief priest and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he had been raised back from the dead, raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first. Take a guard, Pilate answered. Go make the tomb as secure as you know how. So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting a guard. Can you just experience the despair of that day? Put yourself in Mary's shoes, Mother Mary. She's watched her son be tortured right before her eyes. And then she saw him hung on the cross. She saw him die. She's at his grave mourning. She didn't realize what's the impact of everything going on. Guys, all of the disciples, everybody that was there, they had turned their back on him. So they were not only covered in grief, but also guilt for turning their back on the Lord Jesus. I know Peter was. Says that he went off crying. I mean weeping because he had denied his Lord. They lost their religion because all of their religion was based on the Messiah. And they thought the Messiah was gone. This ain't the guy. In fact, the apostle said that, you know, we hoped that he was the one. But how could he be the one? He's dead. See, even they were expecting a king to come and defeat Rome in the physical, not in the spiritual. As I said last week, the kingdom, this world is not the kingdom of Christ. His kingdom is in the human heart. In the heart. Amen? But can you just experience, imagine the grief that was experienced there. They were going through. They lost their religion, and like I said, it was Messiah. I think it was just like a dark cloud kind of gloom dropped over upon everybody that day. Those who, his disciples, his true disciples who loved him. So hopefully I put you there when they laid him in the tomb. But were you there when he rose up from the grave? See, the emotions are starting to come around right now. You've had this roller coaster, this highs and lows down there, down low, down in the valley. But we're starting to come back up now with the roller coaster. These emotions are getting better. It's the good news is coming. You experience the joy of that day. Can you imagine the exuberance of that Easter morning? The resurrection was biblically and logically necessary, guys. Because God in Christ, through Christ, defeated sin and he defeated Satan. And by him raising from the dead, by him raised from that tomb, resurrected, he defeated death. He defeated death. It's no wonder the angels said, go spread the news, the good news. There's a story I want to share with you about a lady's name was Marty Halliburton. I'm not sure it's Halliburton or Halliburton. And her husband, Porter. Her husband, Porter, had been shot down in the Vietnam War. And the Navy came and knocked on her door and gave her the news that her husband had died. And Marty was, oh man, she was just devastated. You know, In the ensuing days, they had placed a marker on the family cemetery for Porter. All the flags in the town were ordered to be half-mast for on his for him. And it's like 18 months have gone by. She's just still can't. I mean, her countenance is down. You know what? When you're just numb, and there's like no emotion in you. That's the way she felt. Because the man that she had put so much faith into had died. So she was devastated. She was in despair. And then, like I said, 18 months later, the Navy came with some more news. They said that he wasn't dead. He was a prisoner of war. And that they think he's in good health, not you know, not bad. But they told her, don't tell anybody. Because if you tell somebody and the news gets out, we're afraid that they may make it hard on the POWs in that camp, including Porter. Well, how do you do that, guys? She's down. She's not really cracking a smile. People haven't seen any excitement or joy in her for 18 months. How can you explain the new sparkle in your eye? In her eye. How can you explain these things, that you have joy once again in your heart? How can you explain that? Well, you can't. How do you get around your friends without just blurting it out? You know, because you're so excited that your husband's alive again. You thought he was dead, but he's not. So then the Navy said, you know, it's going to be way too hard to contain this. So they went ahead and changed his status to prisoner of war. And she got on the phone, his wife got on the phone and called everybody she could think of on her phone list. He's alive! He's alive! That's what she was thinking. Guys, that's the way that roller coaster was then. They were down, man. They were down because they thought Christ was dead. But when he rose back to life, guys, you can't keep that secret. You can't keep a secret like that. That kind of good news is going to be seen in your countenance. Amen. Can't keep the resurrection secret. We should live out the joy of it every day. And we do that by giving our lives without reservation to our Lord. Were you there? Were you there when they crucified our Lord? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? And were you there when he rose up from the grave? Because let me tell you something, guys, I was there. I was there every minute of it. I felt the despair of my sins going on him to make it to the point where he had to do what he did. He did it because he loved me. But that doesn't change the fact that he had to do it because of my sin and because of your sin. Amen? I asked the question, were you there? If you wasn't, would you like to be? Because guys, I'm going to tell you something. That's a high and low that you just need to experience if you've never experienced. To know that your sins are forgiven. To know that you're going to heaven because of what he did on that cross, going up to that cross. The payment he paid for your sins. The death he experienced so that we could have life. So that we could have a redeemer. And then the life. life. Bring me back to life. And in defeating death. Oh, death, where is your victory? Your sting, or old grave, where is your victory? From death unto life, he passes. We follow in there. We are more than conquerors. If you want to ask Christ in your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting. This is also, guys, I want to point out that the altar is open. It's open all the time. This time of the service is open. If you have something that's weighing heavy on your heart, don't you dare leave this church with it. I think that's a sin. This is a hospital. You bring your troubles up here to the altar and lay them down. Give us here at the church the honor of coming beside you and praying with you to help you through what you're going through. If you want to ask Christ in your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting. Though. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you have that emptiness that I described early in my prayer, you don't know what's missing, you just know something. More importantly than that, that you feel a draw right now, which is the Holy Spirit drawing you towards Himself. Right now is the time of salvation, not tomorrow, but right now, the Bible says, this moment. If you want to ask Christ in your heart to say a simple prayer like this, first thing you got to do, guys, is admit to Him, Lord, I am a sinner. Right now, Lord, I turn from that sin. I agree, Lord, that you are right and I am wrong. I want to do things your way. So, Jesus, I'm asking you to come into my heart now. I receive you by faith into my spirit. I believe you died on that cross for my sins. That you rose back to life. You're living in me now. I recognize you as my God, my Lord, my friend, and from this moment forward I will serve only you. In Jesus' precious, precious name, amen. You said that prayer for the first time, guys. I say this every week. If you're here in the church, come see me right after services. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, my telephone number's right here. That is by far the most important decision you'll ever make in your life, and I dearly need to talk to you about it. All right, guys, we're going to have communion. You know, usually here at Rafter Jet, because we have communion on the first Sunday of every month. So usually when Easter falls, we have communion twice in that month. It falls on the first Sunday of this month, and this time. So Brian is going to sing a song, Brian and Robert. And I want you to meditate. While they do that, I want you to pray and ask God to search your heart. Guys, just to repent of any sins that you know of. Ask Him to reveal anything that's holding you back to what we got. Hold you back from communion. It's so important that we do this with a clear heart.
Salvation in the blood.
The Bible says in Matthew 26:26, while they were in the upper room, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin." Father God, we love you so, so very much. Father, we ask that you just receive this as a sacrifice before you, Father God, us giving you honor on this, especially this day. Lord Jesus, it's all about you. It's your body. In fact, we are your body here on earth. But at least for this brief moment in time, we're right with you. We're right with you personally, and because of that, you're right in the middle of this church where you belong, centered because of that. Father, forgive us as we go out into the world and we lose our focus and we fall short. And Lord, then we have to come back in here a month from now and do it all over again. But Lord, at least for this brief moment in time, we are right with you, and everything's good in the universe. Lord, and as we go to our homes today, as we do the Easter egg hunts and things like that, Father, may we just remember what this day is truly about. It's about your resurrection, you rising from that grave, so that we can have new life, we can have abundant life through you. Father, as we, until we get back up here next Sunday, Father, we ask for your perfect speed in our lives, and we ask for your favor. And just remind us that we are your ambassadors in the lost and dying world. We ask this and all things in Jesus' precious, precious name. Amen. All right, guys. Love you.